Hey everyone, this is Kelvin. I'm talking to Hamish Glencross of Godthrymm. How are you doing, Hamish?
Very well. Thank you very much, Kelvin. Thank you for the opportunity to talk this evening. Really enjoying the opportunity to talk about our new album, Distortions. So thank you.
Yeah, that's coming out August 18th. So everyone check it out. It's the second album from Godthrymm. I got the first one here, the Reflections album, which was a really good album. Came out 2020, so the second album, Distortions, will be out.
Second album coming out August 18th. I'll take you your vinyl copy and then raise it up for. And this is how our new album's looking, full size. Absolutely just love how the artworks come out on this. Just, you know, a beautiful piece of work. Andy Green's done such an amazing job. So, yeah, just fantastic.
Yeah, I pre-ordered one, so I got to wait a few more weeks. But, yeah, I definitely checked out the promo that was sent to me. And, yeah, I really enjoy it.
Great.
For people who aren't familiar with Godthrymm, Godthrymm started in 2017, and you're currently based out of Halifax, West Yorkshire, England. Am I correct?
Yep, absolutely right. Yep. And north of England, very fortunate to have, you know, such a rich musical history, of, especially for our style of music in what is, you know, a fairly small little spot in the world. So, yeah, a grand place to be, and some great bands, great people. So just, you know, very pleased to be a part of that.
Yeah, you've been a part of some pretty influential bands like My Dying Bride, Solstice. What is it about like this style of music that really kind of drew you towards like, referring to like doom, like the doom metal style, like what really drew you to that style?
So I think going back to the very start when I was kind of first getting, you know, kind of an interest into heavier spheres of music. It was very much kind of from, you know, my parents initially, but my dad listening to, you know, some good guitar-based music like Free, the old kind of, you know, British blues rock kind of band, and had some, you know, a very kind of, you know, soulful, very, you know, heavy feel guitar solos and things, which I kind of really, really loved. And as I was getting more into it, my dad gave me a copy of the album Paranoid by Black Sabbath, which absolutely loved from start to finish, but was just absolutely kind of blown away by like Electric Funeral and Hand of Doom, and was just like, wow, this, you know, music can be so heavy and just like seemed to have such, you know, dark, oppressive kind of atmosphere. And so was very, very kind of much drawn to that. And, you know, outside of that was listening to, you know, a lot of, you know, kind of, yeah, heavy metal and thrash, and, you know, MSG, you know, Metallica, Megadeth and things like that. But I just really kept kind of coming back to, you know, this, you know, darker, heavier music. And then when, certainly when Paradise Lost were then starting out, and again, geographically very fortunate here, the, you know, Tuds, the original drummer, just like, you know, him and his family lived just over the road from, you know, me and my family as well. So, checking out them with this, you know, kind of darker, twisted take on the style of music, I just thought was just absolutely amazing. And just, you know, I knew I wanted to be involved in music in some way or another, and you know, guitar seemed like the obvious kind of choice, because, you know, my dad had guitars in the house as well, and I was able to, you know, pick up and play, and he'd start showing me some things, and it just appealed kind of so much. And and then starting off in bands, just wanted to, you know, try and invoke the same kind of, you know, feelings and appreciation that I'd had with being exposed to this music. And then really, you know, was able to pursue that further and further in the, you know, the first bands I was in, and then, you know, Sears Tear into Solstice into My Dying Bride was just like, wow. And you know, My Dying Bride, you know, since hearing the Towards the Sinister demo that I got off an old girlfriend at the time, was just, you know, this dark, oppressive, you know, nightmare kind of music, was just like, wow, this is just amazing. And then how in just, you know, a spot later than that, it's, you know, developing into this, you know, very kind of mournful and melodic kind of, you know, guitar playing as well, that you know, just really, really appeals to me so much. I love you know, melodied harmony, layers of guitars, and all of this. So yeah, I just wanted to kind of pursue that, because I just, it speaks to me, it makes me, you know, feel, you know, I kind of belong in kind of some ways. You know, we have you know, darker emotions and, you know, sadness and, you know, melancholy at times, and this is, you know, a style of music where you can kind of really channel that through this music. It's a very cathartic style of music, I think.
Yeah, I agree. There's so many layers. Like, I like to buy music like on like the vinyl records, and like definitely like doom, you know, just like that music with a lot of atmosphere is what I really like to collect on vinyl. And yeah, your work definitely falls into that.
It works so great with vinyl as well, because I still love, you know, the idea of listening to whole albums at a time as well. Whereas, like, you know, kind of so much of music is kind of consumed in kind of bits, and there's, you know, far too much, you know, that kind of time of just like, you know, playlists, individual songs, you know, having a library on shuffle and that kind of thing. But no, actually giving a full album the attention and appreciation it deserves, I think, is amazing. And that's why vinyl is such a kind of great way of, you know, really experiencing an album as a whole. It's, you know, you're focused on it. You could get the enjoyment of the full size kind of artwork and just kind of look into the lyric sheets. And this is what I do when, you know, I was younger and would get a new album. I would always kind of make a point of buying it on vinyl. And when first listening through to it, would be listening intently with the lyric sheet as well, and just kind of wanting to study it really at that point. So it's certainly a lot more than just a kind of casual listening experience, definitely.
Yeah, for sure. And then along with some of the bands we mentioned, this band here, Vallenfyre, I know they're not active anymore, but can you kind of talk about your involvement and kind of like up to like when they ended and when Godthrymm started?
Yeah, so Vallenfyre came about on you know, a background of you know, friendships of many, many years. You know, been friends with Greg McIntosh and Scoop Gladuck for you know, years upon years, and you know, we're all you know, would make a point of you know, seeing each other kind of where we could and hanging out and catching up with each other. And you know, a few times over, kind of spoken about you know, how cool it would be for, you know, to kind of be really mixing in, you know, a lot of the, you know, kind of Celtic Frost's you know, kind of, you know, faster and more savage kind of angles with, you know, some of what doom was morphing into kind of later as well. And so, you know, quite like the idea of, you know, doing something like that. And then Greg, of course, very keen to bring in a lot of the, you know, kind of, you know, punkier kind of influence and, you know, crustier death metal side of things, and just kind of, you know, revisiting a lot of music that he was very passionate about, you know, in his youth as well. So it was, you know, a sad circumstance that led to the formation of that band with, you know, the passing of Greg's dad, and then him then, you know, turning to, you know, the music as a vehicle of grief, and then writing these songs as a way of, you know, kind of working through, you know, his kind of emotions and you know, the grief process. And then when it came to recording them, he wanted to do it with close friends. And so that's how that band kind of formed. And as we went on and did some shows, they became, apparent that, kind of wanted to push it further and do some more as well. And we had a really great time with the albums we recorded, the shows that we did. It's a shame the only constant throughout the band was both myself and Greg in the band all the way through. I contributed, some small degree in regards to kind of music, but it was very, very much, Greg's baby. And so as the band was, coming to the end of its kind of, cycle, then I was, very keen to be starting something else, very much, my own and, a new passion. And it was, returning to the, kind of a classic doom template and the old albums I loved before that. I just fell in love with all over again, and then just wanted to, kind of pursue this. And so the first album, Reflections, is very much a kind of, a nod to, the old albums and that scene that I loved so much. And then now, much like what happened with Vallenfyre as well, just like kind of want to push it further, make the extremes, more pronounced, really. So, there's a lot more melody, a lot more harmony. There's greater layering of soundscaping, and just, kind of wanting to push it to the next level, really. I think the musical evolution that we've gone through is really quite, there to be heard for people who, want to give it a listen. We're very proud of what we've accomplished here. And it's become, not only is it, my sole musical outlet, but it's one that I'm, deeply passionate about as well. So it's a very personal band. Thankfully, everyone involved in the band very much kind of, supports the same kind of vision, and then brings in their own, skill and, musicality into it as well, giving a good, rich tapestry to work from.
Yeah, no, that's cool. Thanks for kind of like sharing all that with people who aren't too familiar. With Godthrymm, I'll be honest, I picked up the album when it came out just because of the record label that released it, Profound Lore. I'm such a fan of Profound Lore. Pretty much anything they put out, I'm gonna listen to. And that's kind of how I picked up on that first album. And then so the second album will be coming out. What would you say are kind of some of the major changes or differences from the first album?
I just think that we've just kind of really, kind of expanded upon, the sound and the sonic palette available to us. I think there's been a lot of refining of certain aspects. I think, the melodic aspect has pushed that much more. By bringing Godthrymm full-time into the band, she brings, such a class and beauty with her vocals and harmonies there. That in turn then kind of inspired me to want to push myself further as a vocalist as well, because I'm still, fairly new to being a vocalist. I've been playing in bands for 30 years now at this point, but always kind of primarily as a guitar player. And now then finding myself as the vocalist in a band is still fairly new. And on the first album, I think, I was very much kind of finding voice and place in some ways, and didn't quite have the confidence to go quite all in with some of the kind of clean vocals and melodic style that I now feel a lot more comfortable and inspired to do, with the confidence of knowing that I'm not, the sole vocalist, and then it's shared with someone else, and we can do harmony stuff as well, and that just took off kind of simultaneously took off some pressure. But as I say, it was just like everything had kind of raised, you know, the standard so much that just wanted to do better and do more. There was a couple of songs on the first album where they initially kind of tried a cleaner vocal style, but didn't quite have the confidence to kind of fully see it through. So went to a rougher vocal style, but this time around, there's a lot less of the kind of rougher vocals. There's a bit of grit in some areas, but it's a lot cleaner than before. I think the production is dramatically improved. I think that it sounds, you know, very big, very grand, very polished. And I think Andy Hawkins did such an amazing job of giving each kind of instrument the space it needed to be able to complement each other, where at times there's, you know, huge drums, you know, very, you know, musical counterpoint from the bass guitar, big heavy rhythm guitars, multiple layers of, you know, guitar harmonies and keyboards and vocals as well. But rather than being swamped and things fighting for the same frequencies, everything's got like space to breathe. And I think it's a great production job, and the mastering I think has really allowed that to shine. So it's just a big evolution from kind of before, and still very much love that first album, and it does what it kind of intended to do. But right now it just wanted to kind of push things further, and we kind of really think we've done that, and I feel very, very inspired by what we've done and want to do more, and very much look forward to, you know, continuing to create in the future.
Yeah, I just want to mention your vocals on this new album. Like, I really dig it. I mean, if people want to, I mean, this is just my own personal comparison, but has a lot of like Alice in Chains, like Layne Staley, like style, which is pretty cool. This is, you know, he's like one of the best vocalists, and to hear your vocals sound like that.
Well, thank you. That is, you know, incredibly humbling. And I mean, Layne Staley and Jerry Cantrell's vocals, their dual vocal work was just amazing. And, you know, they're both just great vocalists and work so very well together. So, I feel honored that might even be put in the same sentence. So that's cool.
Yeah. And then the track Follow Me has Aaron Stainthorpe as a guest. One of your former like bandmates. How did that come about?
So, I mean, we've been, you know, close friends for such a long time, and you know, done so much together over the years. It's just you know, he's a very special friend and someone who you know, I greatly admire, as well as you know, class as you know, a very dear friend. So working on the song Follow Me, and it was very clearly being a very grand, epic, ambitious doom song with lots going on, a bit of a, you know, I might call it a bit of a kitchen sink song, like you're throwing everything into it. You know, there's so many layers of guitars, keys, vocals, just so much. And had the an idea of this kind of, you know, ambition to be having, you know, a very grand spoken, you know, narration in there as well. And when I was demoing the song up, I was doing that myself at first and trying to go for a bit of a Hammer horror kind of, you know, vibe. But, you know, I couldn't do, you know, Christopher Lee quite as much. And so what I was doing though, made me kind of think, does it sound like I'm trying to go down a bit of an Aaron Stainthorpe kind of angle? Well, if that's the case, let's just, you know, ring the man himself and ask, would he be interested in doing a guest spot? And thinking what a, you know, nice thing that would be. Only just, you know, for the song, it would be, you know, so much improved by it, but it would also be, you know, a real nice thing for us to do, you know, doing something musical together again, and publicly as well, that, you know, folk to see that, yeah, we you know, are still, you know, kind of good friends, and there's, you know, huge amounts of respect there as well. So I think it was very, very special having him come and joining us, you know, for that bit of that song. Just wonderful. Just as soon as he, you know, was doing it, he just did kind of did one take, and it was like, wow, yeah, that's just amazing. Yeah, because he was saying at first, you know, oh, yours sounded good. Why do you really need me to do it? It's like, nah, you know, full well, you know, his voice has got such a, you know, character to it. It's yeah, it's amazing.
No, it's really great. And then one more thing about the album. Can you talk about any of like the stories or the lyrics about the or on the new album?
Yeah, certainly. There's because on one hand there's some you know, some themes of you know, loss and grief, which you know, I pulled from, you know, kind of direct experience where we've you know, lost, you know, some very, you know, some very dear people to us. And so you know, it can go from, you know, the very direct you know, kind of tribute, like Echoes is really that, is, you know, kind of very much, you know, directed towards a very dear friend that we lost. And Pictures Remain is then very much the, you know, kind of state of grief afterwards, but kind of acknowledging that, you know, loss comes, you know, the pain of loss is very much because, you know, you have loved and had something, you know, special in your life that you've now lost, and trying to then kind of really kind of focus on, you know, the beauty of what there was, and, you know, and there's, you know, some degree of hope in there, I think, which then kind of ties into then the phase of other themes on the album, like As Titans, which is very much looking over kind of, you know, life and trials and, you know, the challenges that kind of make us stronger. And then, you know, I mean, you know, looking at a patchwork of scars that have, you know, show, you know, kind of a history of, you know, everything that's, you know, kind of brought a person to this point where they are now. You know, we've learned, loved loss, learned from that, learned to appreciate what we have. And so that's, you know, a theme that's touched on a couple of times, of just trying to, you know, kind of learn from life's challenges, and just trying to strive to be the best person that we kind of can, when at times, you know, we can be wrestling with, you know, devils being, you know, external, environmental, devils or whatever things being thrown that way, or indeed even internal ones where, you know, it could be faced with, you know, our own, you know, kind of desires or poor choices and, you know, kind of regret, and trying to make peace with yourself, you know, regrets of actions or inactions of the past, and just trying to kind of learn and grow from that as well, which, you know, obsess and regress is, you know, directly related from that too, because it's not wanting to kind of obsess and focus too much on, you know, aspects of the past, when you kind of want to try and learn from it and move on and move to the future, and you know, otherwise, and then just find yourself in a bit of a kind of a negative cycle of being affected by something when you kind of need to learn from it and move forward. So there's kind of a bit of a journey in there, and but then on the flip side, then there's a song like Unseen Unheard that was just simply inspired by the film Predator. So, you know, it's
awesome.
That's kind of out on a limb, that one, I think, really.
Yeah. Well, I can't wait to hear it, yeah.
That was the original idea for that kind of song. You, Bob, had the kind of idea of, you know, the idea of kind of being, you know, hunted. And, but then kind of morphed that idea into, you know, to fit more with the rest of the album as well. And like saying that, you know, okay, so this, you know, this unseen, you know, kind of, you know, hunter or predator could be, you know, kind of own internal demons. So, yeah. You know, back into the theme again. So it wasn't just, you know, Arnold Schwarzenegger.
Okay. Yeah. No problem. Yeah. I can't wait to hear it. You know, the album Distortions by Godthrymm, August 18th. Everyone, like, you know, pick it up, stream it, or, you know, find some way to support it. I don't want to go over my time, but yeah, thanks, Hamish, for talking with me. I really appreciate it. And yeah, I can't say enough. Everyone, check out the new Godthrymm album.
Thank you so much. Greatly appreciated. You know, the digital single Echoes is out and available to listen to now, and we've just released the video single for the song Devils as well. So please do check them out, and you know, like and share if you see fit. Hope you find something to appreciate in there, and if not, thank you so much for your time.
All right, yeah, no problem. All right. Incredible.